It's a Sid Rosenberg show.
Sid Rosenberg is on
right now.
Fly ball, hit to left. Way back is Ackley, way back there. Wave that baby bye-bye into the bullpen. And here in the eighth inning with the bases empty, Steve Pierce, with his 10th home run, has given the Orioles a one-run lead.
Adam was throwing the ball good, and Pierce is a guy that plays mostly against left-handers. And, you know, as I said, if we were starting him, I could have 45 or 50 pitches. And, he left the breaking ball up.
Hey, Ryan, got him looking. And he got him with another breaking ball. How about that? Britton ends the game with back-to-back breaking pitches. And the Orioles in the win column again.
What was your evaluation of Sabathia, and how do you think the knee came out of tonight?
The knee came out good. Obviously, we'll know more tomorrow, but he said it felt good, and I thought he threw a good game.
Breaking ball hit in the air, deep to left center. It's going for a ride. It's not coming back. It's into the bullpen. Unbelievable. Yoenis Cespedes hits a two-run homer. The Mets have taken a 4-2 lead. The latest chapter in this fairy tale season has been written by the author, who seems to be writing another one every night. For Cespedes, his 14th home run. Storin gives it up again. 4-2 New York. You have to see it or hear it to believe it, and I'm not sure that I do.
I don't know where to hit Cespedes, because I want to try to get him up there as much as I can right now, because he seems to be getting every big hit there is. But
swinging a high fly ball to left field. This should do it. Cespedes under it, waiting, makes the catch, put it in the books. The New York Mets have stormed into Washington and swept a three-game series from the Washington Nationals. And if they have not exactly delivered the knockout punch, they have left the Nationals staggering against the ropes and wondering if they have anything left.
This has been the biggest three games I've had in my career. And, you know, exciting games. Every one of them was a great game. You know, just huge comebacks, big hits, you know, inspirational play by every guy that was out there. And it was really, really great to be a part of it all. And when Kelly hit the home run, you know, and then Grandy got on, I'm telling you, the energy in the dugout went crazy. And you know, as I told you guys, you know, that the adrenaline can wear you down. And it was kind of, you know, pretty quiet most of the night. And then when Grandy got out, all of a sudden the energy picked up. And when he hit that home run, it was, I mean, you saw Juris at the end of the game still throwing 98-99, his third night in a row. So it created a lot of positives.
Former tennis star James Blake was slammed to the ground, handcuffed and detained for about 15 minutes in New York City. Police mistakenly thought he was the suspect in an identity theft ring. The incident happened as Blake, formerly the world's fourth-ranked player, was waiting for a car outside a Midtown Manhattan hotel to take him to the U.S. Open. Blake says after being shoved to the sidewalk, he was detained by five white plainclothes officers. The tennis player stopped short of saying it was racial profiling, but he did want an apology.
Have you had any conversation with him at all about that, with the cops yet?
Not yet.
What would you like to hear from him?
An apology.
New York police released a statement saying once Blake was properly identified and found to have no connection to the investigation, he was released from police custody immediately. In regards to the alleged improper use of force, the police commissioner directed the Internal Affairs Bureau to investigate.
Let's talk about Donald Trump. He had some choice remarks about you, according to Rolling Stone magazine. While you came on the TV, he was quoted by the Rolling Stone reporter saying, "Look at that face. Would anyone vote for that? Can you imagine that, the face of our next president? I mean, she's a woman, and I'm not supposed to say bad things, but really, folks, come on. Are we serious?" Your reaction?
Well, I think those comments speak for themselves. And all the many, many, many thousands of voters out there that are helping me climb in the polls, yes, they're very serious.
What do you take that to mean? Look at that face. Would anyone vote for that?
I have no idea. And, you know, honestly, Megan, I'm not going to spend a single cycle wondering what Donald Trump means. But maybe, just maybe, I'm getting under his skin a little bit because I am climbing in the polls.
Our next guest really doesn't need much of an introduction. Businessman Donald Trump.
It's the end of the world as we know it. It's the end of the world as we know it. It's the end of the world as we know it.
Thank you very much, everybody. It's such an honor. I was called by Senator Cruz a few days ago, and he said, do you think we can get a really good crowd out here to protest this incompetent deal? And I said, boy, can we get a crowd. And that was 3 days ago, and look what shows up. And I want to thank you. I want to thank you. So I've been doing deals for a long time. I've been making lots of wonderful deals, great deals. That's what I do. Never, ever, ever in my life have I seen any transaction so incompetently negotiated as our deal with Iran. And I mean never. Now, Ted and everybody else have gone through all of the details, and we can talk about the 24 days, which is ridiculous. We can talk about the $150 billion, which, by the way, they get, even if the deal isn't approved, they get it just for going to the table. We can talk about the fact that we have four wonderful people over there, and frankly, they're never going to come back with this group. And I will say this, if I win the presidency, I guarantee you that those four prisoners are back in our country before I ever take office. I guarantee that.
As far as I know, gays and lesbians are the only countries where they don't get persecuted are America and Israel. That doesn't mean that we have to change the tradition of marriage or anything else to further accommodate their feelings. We don't imprison them. We don't stone them. We don't ostracize them. We don't keep them out of schools. We don't do anything except allow them freedoms that every other citizen has.
That is not true. We do ostracize them. And by the way,
who ostracizes them? Look at television.
I understand entertainment is one thing. Talk to a gay person about going after a job. You put a gay person or a straight person, I'm not talking about being on the E! Channel here or working with Harvey Levin. That gay person's not going to get that job. And by the way,
What are you talking about?
My mother says the same thing. She goes, I'm all for gay marriage. I'm okay with it. They just shouldn't have any kids. The way you just talked about gay people really smells of homophobia to me. So you say you don't ostracize them, but you certainly are.
On any day of the week, at any hour of the day, New York City is in motion. A heart beating to a perpetual rhythm. No one, least of all the 8 million people who give the city life, think that it could all change in an instant. But when you least expect it, when all you can think about are catching trains and racing to the office, it can suddenly stop. And when it does, what we hold on to are the little things. Those moments that once seemed so ordinary.
My dad drove me to work maybe about a week before September 11th in his fire chief's car, just me and him. My dad was Chief Gerard, or Jerry, Barbara, New York City Fire Department. The best dad a girl could have. And one of the many things he gave me was a love for the Yankees, because he grew up with that. We always sort of incorporated the Yankees in our summer. He pulled over between the World Trade Center and Two World Financial, where I used to work, then pulled out of his wallet these four Yankee tickets for September 10th. And he wanted me to have these tickets, and we kind of went back and forth, you know, Dad, why don't you go? Why don't we go together? And he said, no, that Tuesday morning, which was the 11th, we have a big chief's meeting, and I want to get there on time, so I want you to go.
Tonight's game here at Yankee Stadium has been postponed.
Actually, it's September 10th, the game ended up being rained out anyway. And it was the last time I saw him was when he gave me the Yankee tickets.
Just into our newsroom, a plane has crashed into the World Trade Center.
A major terror attack in the United States and here in New York on the World Trade Tower.
You got a face not spoiled by beauty. I have some scars from where I've been. You got eyes that can see right through me. You're not afraid of anything they've seen. I was told that I would feel nothing the first time. I don't know how these cuts heal, but in you I found a rhyme. If there is a light, you can always conversation, a conversation only we could make. You're breaking into my imagination. Whatever's in there, it's yours to take. I was told I feel nothing the first time.
Can't believe 14 years ago tomorrow, that awful day, the most tragic day in the history of the United States. I guess some of the old generation may say Pearl Harbor, but certainly all we saw were the footage and the clippings and all that stuff. But in our lifetime, nothing has even come close to what I witnessed, actually, was a part of 14 years ago tomorrow, and that, of course, 9/11. That was a great open put together once again by Steve Zemack, mostly, and Ricky Baloupe and Eric Langell, and it really gave you a taste of everything going on, from the ultimate high with the Mets, with that amazing, amazing win again last night, three consecutive comeback wins. They have now swept the Nationals in consecutive series, and don't look now, but they built a seven-game lead atop the Nationals, atop the NL East. The Mets are running away with it. They are clearly the story of this baseball season, and specifically Cespedes. Now look, Kelly Johnson also came to the Mets trade deadline. They made some other moves, right? Tyler Clipper, their eighth inning guy before Familia, big pickup. Juan Uribe's been a nice pickup. Kelly Johnson, big home run last night off Strasburg to tie the game at two before Cespedes delivered the game winner off Drew Storen to win the game. In 36 games as a New York Met, Cespedes has hit 14 home runs. 14. He's knocked in 36 runs. That's an RBI per night. He's your MVP. I'm sorry. I know Rizzo's having a good year and some other guys around the National League. And again, it's going to be difficult to give somebody the NL MVP when he spent about one-sixth of the season inside the National League. But I'm sorry. He is the NL MVP. If Cespedes doesn't get it, it's a joke. Nobody has meant more to their baseball team and lineup. This is a Met team that now scores runs at a big clip that comes back from deficits. They couldn't score in a whorehouse with 5,000 cash 2 months ago. Cespedes arrives, and again, Kelly Johnson, nice pickup. Juan Uribe, nice pickup. Tyler Clipper, nice pickup. This is about Cespedes. He's the MVP of the effing. He may be the best player in baseball. I'm dead serious. He may be the best player in baseball.
And these last three games against Washington, they were all down, and Cespedes was a big part
every game
of the victory.
Two home runs, three-run doubles.
Unreal,
I mean, just amazing. So you get that, and we got a monster four-game series starting in the Bronx tonight between the Yankees and Jays. As you heard, the Yankees lost last night to Baltimore. But the good news for Yankee fans is Toronto got walloped by the Red Sox as well. So the Yankees remain 1.5 behind Toronto, and they can do it now. Four-game set starting in the Bronx tonight. Good pitching matchup. David Price for the Blue Jays, and the rookie who's been great for the Yankees, Luis Severino, on the mound. Tomorrow, it's Estrada and Nova. Saturday, Stroman and Pineda. And the series finale on Sunday features R.A. Dickey and Tanaka. So here's the Yanks' chance. They're either going to do it now or fall way behind. So we'll see. And then, of course, you had the James Blake story, and this is where Black Lives Matter gets right back into business, right? Here's James Blake at one point in his career, the number four tennis player in the world, one of the great American players over the last decade or so. He's standing outside the Grand Hyatt, I think, on 42nd Street, getting ready to go watch the U.S. Open. Next thing you know, this guy comes over and tackles him. He's got five plain-clothed police officers on top of him. They cuff him. And he's saying, oh, hold on, guys, I'm James Blake, I'm the tennis player, I'm really famous. They didn't want to hear it. They thought he was a cell phone thief. Ended up keeping him handcuffed for 30 minutes. Bill Bratton, the commissioner of police up in New York, the headline of today's New York Post, basically, we effed up. We really screwed this one up. James Blake is pissed, as he should be. So once again, here is a story of an innocent black man wrestled and tackled and treated shabbily, unfairly, and illegally by the New York City police. So if, in fact, you're one of those folks that likes to demonize the cops, and boy, do they exist, here's your chance, because I don't care if you're Bo Deedle, I don't care if you're John Cardillo, or the other countless cops we bring on the show to defend the cops, because we love the cops. This is an F-up by the cops. There's no other way to put it. So that is a big story emanating right now from New York City. Donald Trump all over the place. First off, you heard Megyn Kelly interviewing Carly Fiorina, courtesy of Fox News last night. Donald Trump in Rolling Stone magazine saying, how can you take Carly Fiorina serious as a presidential candidate with that face? I mean, not that long ago, Megyn Kelly and Donald Trump went at each other in that first debate. And Megyn Kelly saying that Donald Trump talks about women in incredibly condescending and disrespectful fashion, calling Rosie O'Donnell a pig to start that event a couple of weeks ago. And here's Donald Trump right back at it, talking about Carly Fiorina's face. Well, what's wrong with him? Sorry, I mean, he's my guy still, even though he shunned us again. And his girl Hope Hicks got back to you yesterday and said Donald's not coming on. So he is obviously still really pissed at me from the comments I made about him on the Imus in the Morning Show about 8 years ago. Get over it, Don, okay? You're running for president. Stop being such a wuss all your life. Mr. Tough Guy. I'll kill the Mexicans. I'll kill the Iranians. I'll kill the Iraqis. But I won't talk to Sid Rosenberg. I mean, really? Really, Trump? And I'm still voting for him because I'm not petty like that. But the Fiorina thing is just stupid. I mean, first of all, she's not ugly. Second of all, if she is, well, what is Donald Trump all of a sudden Brad Pitt? What am I missing? I mean, Jesus Christ, Donald Trump, have you looked in the mirror lately?
And you're right, she's not an ugly lady.
No.
She's older, and you know what? When she's actually walking around wearing normal clothes, she looks fashionable. She looks good.
She's fine. I mean, fine. I didn't realize you had to look like Megyn Kelly to be president, you know? If Carly Fiorina was trying to be the star of Taboo 80, a porn film, I may have an issue with that. Jesus, Trump. And then he's outside D.C. with Ted Cruz. And look, I hate the Iran deal as well. In fact, I think any Jew that is for that deal, like this creep, Debbie Wasserman Schultz, she should be, you should lose your Jewish right. You automatically go from a Jew to a guy as soon as you say, I'm okay with that deal. So I'm all for that, but I don't know. Even at the rally yesterday, talking about the $150 billion and talking about the hostages and all that stuff. Even when he was saying stuff that I agree with, he still sounded kind of clumsy, Donald Trump. I mean, did you not think so?
Yeah.
Kind of clumsy,
but
man.
There's never any script, though.
So
you got to respect that. That's it, he does. Sometimes it's like, there's a little, or he gets off point.
He says the same thing 100,000 times.
Definitely does.
Over and over. And it's like, is there a plan B? Is there got something else to say, Donald, besides Russia, China, the $150 billion, I'm getting the hostages out, I'm building the wall? I mean, I guess what I'm trying to say is maybe I am petty because I'm so pissed at him and Hope Hicks and the rest of them for turning us down again yesterday that now I'm kind of looking for reasons to get off the Trump train.
Well, he didn't sound all that presidential yesterday.
Thank you.
He sounded almost like a guy in the crowd just screaming.
Bro, he sounded like Vince McMahon at a Raw event, basically.
Carnival
at a WWE,
Barker, yeah.
Exactly. So, which is what he's done the whole time. And
I mean, but I'd still like to hear a little more stuff like Lindsey Graham did.
You love Lindsey Graham.
Well, I mean, it's impressive when they can actually break down stuff and sound like they know what they're talking about and they've got military experience. And
so you're back on the Lindsey Graham deal now.
Well, he impressed me that day. I like.
And you're disgusted with Mike Huckabee, especially when we've got something with Huckabee from Megyn Kelly last night.
Talking
about the Kim Davis thing,
yeah,
which is where Joyce Kaufman and I started a fight on this program yesterday, and then I took it to her show. Where I just kicked her. I mean, I destroyed her. And you heard a clip there of us talking about homosexuals. And I love Joyce to death. She knows that. And I mean that. I'm not being insincere. I love Joyce. I love her. I think she's a wonderful talent. I think she's a really good person. But she's lost. And she's so wrapped up in this nonsense, this religion, that she doesn't even know when she's being homophobic, which she is. She is really homophobic. I mean, she's like the rest of these folks that say, no, I got no issue with them, but. And once you say but, of course, you've got an issue. So here's Huckabee last night going on and on about Kim Davis, who's nothing but a common criminal, by the way. She's not a martyr. She's done nothing fantastic. She should not be celebrated. She should be put right back in jail, in fact, if she does the same crap on Monday. People like Joyce and Mike Huckabee are making her into Rosa Parks. Here's the problem. Here's the problem. Well, Martin Luther King Jr., God rest his soul, was there battling for civil rights. He was not discriminating. Rosa Parks was not discriminating. What Joyce can't seem to understand, and Huckabee and the rest of these morons is Kim Davis, not that Joyce is a moron, but Kim Davis is discriminating, unlike Martin Luther King or Rosa Parks. She's saying, you're gay. See the difference?
Yeah, well, I mean, everyone's all proud of her because she's sticking to her convictions, but her convictions are awful.
Are illegal. It's illegal. Yeah, she's like, a criminal.
It's like with the rebel flag, you know? Everyone was, these were proud soldiers back in the Civil War, but they were standing up for their convictions, but their convictions were, hey, we don't want to lose slavery.
That's it, basically. Right.
Know, the conviction's right. Bad from right. The beginning.
I want a black person at my house that'll, you know, basically do my dishes and rake my fields, and I can bang their daughters when they're old enough.
But these guys were soldiers.
Basically,
they stood up for what they believed in.
Oh, please.
What they believed in was
garbage.
Slavery.
Could not agree more. And finally, of course, the last thing you heard in the open, and we open with this, is I can't believe it's 14 years already, but tomorrow we commemorate. We don't, no anniversaries for me. Anniversaries for me are meant for weddings and birthdays and stuff like that. We commemorate this tragic day, which I was a part of. I was on the air. We've got that chilling audio. We'll play it today and tomorrow with Imus talking about the Giants-Broncos game that was played the night before, Monday, September 10th, the first Monday Night Football game of the year. The football Giants, fresh off a Super Bowl loss to the Baltimore Ravens, got blown out in Denver. Brian Griese had a great game. Terrell Davis had a great game. In fact, the Giants tried to fly back to New Jersey on the red eye late Monday from Colorado after getting blown out by the Broncos, and they couldn't land the plane, or they may have landed the plane moments before the first plane hit the tower, I forget. But anyway, I was on the air with Imus talking about the Giants-Broncos game when the first plane hit. I remained on the air with Imus till the second plane hit. At that point, we scrapped all the sports. At WFAN, mind you, the biggest sports station in the country and the biggest in the history of the industry, sports were done. As soon as Warner Wolf, who does sports on Imus now for many, many years, and of course is a TV sports guy, as soon as he called in, because he lived right across the street from the towers, right across the street in Battery Park, as soon as he called in and said, oh my God, I just watched the tower literally crumble to the ground. Literally. That was it. There was no more sports on WFAN. And Imus stayed on for like 10 hours that day, just like Howard Stern did and others around the city. And it was a brutal, brutal time. I lived in Chelsea, 21st Street and 8th Avenue, maybe a mile and a half away from the actual site. And I remember for days, my eyes were bloodshot and burning from all the smoke, the smell of death. I could still hear the beeping because I walked right by that site that night. We had gone to my wife, Danielle. Her best friend, Paige, was dating a guy named Michael at the time. And Michael's brother worked at Cantor Fitzgerald, which was 105th floor, something like that, right above Boomer Esiason's office and right below the restaurant there. And we know, of course, that everybody in the building that day that worked at Cantor Fitzgerald died, every single person. So we went back to Danielle's friend Paige's apartment. She lives on 82nd and 3rd, the Upper East Side. And we sat there all day waiting for the phone to ring. Michael did, her boyfriend, waiting for his brother to call, hoping, you know, and the phone would ring. We'd all jump up and be like, yes, 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 and we sat there for about 8 hours, and by 11 o'clock that night, after a multitude of phone calls, none of them were his brother, because his brother, in fact, did die that day. And I remember we all left the apartment about 11 o'clock that night, and just like a million other folks in New York City who lost friends and family and just sad, and we walked home with no trains. So we walked all the way from the Upper East Side to Chelsea that night, Danielle and I, and we walked right past the site with the big lights. And you can still, the smoke and you could still hear the fires burning and the clanging of the metal and the beeping from all the firemen's beepers that were on top of the wreckage that day. And like it was yesterday. And the next morning, not that we slept that night, we didn't. Walking out of our apartment in Chelsea, like I said, the smoke billowing right there. We went to a local diner on 8th Avenue. And I remember grabbing the New York Post that next morning, and the first picture I saw was a young man and a young lady holding hands jumping out of the 100th floor of that building because they were not going to be burnt to death by the jet fuel. They would rather jump to their death from 100 stories up. I mean, think about that choice. I'm either going to die inside this place or I'm going to jump. That was the picture of the New York Post. A young couple, literally, in the air, jumping out of the building. So I know a lot of folks want to move on from this, specifically survivors and folks that lost people in the building that day. They can't stand when we bring back these memories of that day. They want to move on. Lots of them remarried, have new families, and they don't want to hear about it. And I respect that and I get that, but I can't do that. I can't do it. We need to be reminded every single day when this creep in the White House makes deals with countries like Iran, who loved that day, mind you. They loved that day. They celebrated there like bin Laden did in the caves of Afghanistan. They loved that day, and they only wish to God there was another day like that, not just for America, but for Israel. And when we sit down and do deals with these people, give them money, deals. What's wrong with having enemies, folks? There's nothing wrong with having enemies, especially when you intimidate them and they're scared of you and you're a power. But when you lose all of that because you turn into a wuss country, that's when it all starts to go badly, and that's when you start making deals with your enemies. But they love that day. Don't kid yourself. Remember that tomorrow for the folks here that are still grieving over what happened 14 years ago. The countries like Iran, to them, that's a grand slam with two out in the bottom of the ninth. 888-640-9385. You've got a great guest list today, as we always do. And we will touch on all the topics that need to be discussed, from baseball to football. The NFL season starts tonight up in Foxborough. Tom Brady, yes, he's out there tonight, and the Patriots taking on the Pittsburgh Steelers, to the great tennis up in New York, the U.S. Open, down to the semifinals for both the men and the women. In fact, Serena plays today, to the 9/11 commemoration, to Kim Davis, to Donald Trump. All of it right here. A very busy Sid Rosenberg show on a Thursday returns right after this. Sid Rosenberg. Now, I met Rick Fox once.
Good morning, Sid.
Do you remember where you and I first met? It was 2000. I moved to New York, and they invited us down to Chelsea, to 15th Street and 9th Avenue. And I saw you getting ready to film Oz.
Yeah, I do remember this. Wow, man. That's like forever ago.
I know.
We're still alive, brother.
Sid Rosenberg. Mornings only on 640 Sports.
When the sun came up this morning and she smiled her smile for me, I felt it for the first time. Something deep inside of me. So you can take your midnight rambling, boy, and you can keep your winding roads. She's living inside my heart now. Living inside. Oh, there's an easiness about her. There's a softness in her way. But she gets me through the hard times. We get closer every day. I know I'll never be alone now, boy. Even if I'm far away, she's living inside my heart now.
Yes. See that naked Demi Moore right now? Walking into the kitchen with the living moonlight shining outside that little kitchen window, and Rob Lowe coming up from behind her. About to put it from behind right there.
I don't remember this scene.
You remember this scene?
No. Never saw the movie, that's why.
Such a great movie about last night. God, it was such a great movie. Everybody knows me and knows my career, knows it may be my favorite. I know it sounds almost sacrilegious. Kim Davis you know, Godfather and Rocky and Jaws and whatever you may like. I don't know, but this movie was great. Rob Lowe, Demi Moore, Elizabeth Perkins, and Belushi was great in this too. Jim, not John, of course. And that scene was the two of them, Rob Lowe and Demi Moore, start to really heat it up, and they, you know, they're hanging out together, and a lot of sex during this during that song.
Oh, okay. I didn't know that.
That's when she was really cute, you know, before, like most women, before they get fake boobs and fake asses and fake lips.
You didn't like her in Striptease?
I liked her better in this movie.
Really?
I know that Striptease, she was all, and G.I. Jane, whatever the hell that was. But, yeah, this is just me. I don't get the whole plastic surgery thing. I'm not, I'm not a huge fan. If you need it, you need it. I mean, Greta Van Susteren, she could use some more, trust me. But, but if you're a pretty girl like Demi Moore, I understand she was an A cup and she wanted to be a C or whatever it is. I don't know. But to me, I just, it annoys me at this point in my life. Like, I watch all these stupid shows on Bravo, all of them. Real Housewives of New York, Real Housewives of Atlanta, Real Housewives of New Jersey. I watch the Married to Medicine. I watch them all. And every one of these women, I'll say broads, but I don't want to upset, Donald Trump's already gone there. Every one of them nauseates me. And some of them are actually very successful. They're doctors and lawyers, but it's like, get a grip, man. Just get a grip. Like, I go to the gym. I obviously care about my body, obviously. I'm vain. I'm working out hard, and it's not a coincidence that my shirts are tighter since I have a little bit of arm now, but that's all I do. I mean, enough with the, to get this done, get that done, get this done. For what?
Well, the shows you watch are the extreme,
yes,
I would
they are.
Say. I mean, these women are.
Carly Fiorina's not doing that.
Well, no, not at all.
And that annoys Donald Trump.
Well,
Hillary Clinton, who's on Ellen DeGeneres' show today, by the way, she ain't doing that. Why is it, by the way, that all these ladies that do run for office are just, they don't look like Megyn Kelly?
Well, evidently there's some beautiful, smart women out there, I guess, right?
Well, they're not running for office, are they?
Well, not that I can see.
Not the last couple of years.
Well, Megyn Kelly isn't running for office.
No, not that I checked, no.
Could she?
Thank God for that.
No?
No. We wouldn't want that.
Well, that's the problem.
Yeah. Summer finals up at the U.S. Open in tennis. Oh, they're going to be great. On the men's side, you have the top seed, Djokovic, taking on the reigning champ. He won it a year ago, the 9-seed Cilic. I love that guy's game. And then you've got Roger Federer, who just made very, very quick work of the Frenchman Garceau last night. He beat him in straight sets, taking on Wawrinka. Stan the Man, also a straight set win over Kevin Anderson the night before, or two nights before. Kevin Anderson looked great in beating Andy Murray. And Stan the Man made very quick work of Kevin Anderson. So you get Djokovic versus Cilic and Federer versus Wawrinka. And that action comes your way tomorrow, Friday, starting at 3 p.m. up in Flushing, Queens. The women, they go at it today. And, of course, you've got Serena. Serena Williams will take on the Italian Vinci. Is that right?
Vinci?
Yes, Roberta Vinci. I believe this is the first time ever that you have two Italian ladies in the semifinals. Vinci is Italian, taking on Serena Williams. And then you have another Italian lady taking on, I believe, the number two seed, Halep. That is correct. Flavia Panetta. First time ever, two Italian ladies make it to the semifinals, and neither one's going to win. So it's great they got there, but
yeah.
Serena's not going to lose, and neither is Halep. So we're all set. Last night was great. I was watching, the Mets. I went back and forth, but I'm not going to lie to you. I actually watched more of the tennis than I did the baseball last night, and specifically Roger Federer, who looked great last night, like I said, an easy straight set win. And who's in the stadium last night for the Roger Federer win? Let's start with, this is not a big surprise. He loved tennis. He was a horrible mayor. Reminds me a lot of Barack Obama, actually. David Dinkins was in the stands, but Alec Baldwin in the stands last night, looking very puffy, very puffy.
He can do that, yeah.
He didn't shave. So he looked a lot like some of those mug shots after he allegedly beat up Kim Basinger. Remember those?
Right.
Yeah. So he was there last night. But the best part was Jimmy Fallon, the great host of The Tonight Show, went there with Justin Timberlake. Those guys are great buddies. They do that great SNL bit, as you know. So at one point last night, during a commercial or during a TV timeout, Fallon and JT get up and start doing that dance.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Well, aren't they cute?
They are kind of cute. I like them.
I mean, they're nice, but I mean, they start doing the dance, yeah. And the crowd appreciated it.
Oh, the crowd went nuts. The crowd went nuts. That's the type of star power the U.S. Open gets. I mean, don't forget the night before when Venus beat Serena in the stadium that night, you had Donald Trump, you had Kim Kardashian, you had Oprah Winfrey. I mean, the stars that show up in Flushing this time of year for the U.S. Open, it's bigger than any Super Bowl, any NBA Finals. Again, think about the last two nights. Donald Trump, Oprah Winfrey, Justin Timberlake, Jimmy Fallon, just to name a few. And last night, like I said, Federer gets it done in a big way, and he's back in the semifinals. What a career that guy's had. We had Rick Macy on a couple days ago from Ava's Tennis Academy, Rick Macy Tennis Academy in Boca. And I asked him flat out, I said, are we watching the best tennis players ever on each side? And he said, yes, without question. Serena is the greatest female tennis player of all time. And Roger Federer is the best male tennis player of all time. And also today, let me remind folks that we start the show after the show. Hey now. What is that? What is that exactly? What is that?
Yeah, what is that, by the way? I'd even like to know that.
Well, we've been convinced by Leo Baldwin, even Ricky Balufe, and a host of others that 4 hours is not enough. That four-hour radio show with me, Sid, and you guys, of course, is not enough, and the fans want more. So in an effort to, A, raise more money, hopefully, advertising, and B, give the fans a little more. Now, listen, this show is very graphic as it is. I don't believe there's another show in America on terrestrial radio, not XM Sirius, that gets away with half the stuff that we get away with. I know that. I readily admit that. We couldn't do this show in New York. We could do the show, obviously, but we couldn't get away with some of the things we say on this show. It would still be great, but we'd have to eliminate some of the things we say here. And even with all that said, people want more, and they want more graphic, and so we're going to do a 20-minute show every day, an uncensored, Sid Uncensored, basically, where right after our show, 1 o'clock, excuse me, not 1 o'clock, 11 a.m., our show ends at 10, and Sid fans can come back an hour later, kind of like the wrap-up show with Gary Delabate and John Hine, except I'm going to be here. See, Howard Stern isn't there for the wrap-up show. He gives it to his guys. I will be here, and you'll get an extra 20 minutes. We'll have guests. We'll recap what happened on the show that day, and it promises to be, you know, dirtier and graphic and uncensored.
I like it.
Yes. Everybody seems to love it, actually. So that starts today. In fact, Liz Mandel, who joins us each and every Tuesday, the world-renowned sex therapist and relationship expert, she's on every Tuesday. It's a great 20-minute segment. She's going to be our first guest on the Uncensored show.
And rightly so.
Yeah.
If anyone deserves the uncensored format, it's her.
Right. So. And you know exactly where that's going to go today. So.
Oh, yeah.
You're looking forward to that, aren't you?
Oh, of course.
Well, today's your last day, so.
What do you mean my last day? It's my last day here as a single man.
Right.
Maybe that.
Right.
It's my last day here for 6 business days.
Maybe.
But I mean, it's not my last day.
We don't know that.
You may die or not.
I remember when
back.
I started this career, my former partner said, Scott Kaplan, he said, you never leave the show because you just never know what could happen, and you know, you never know if the seat's going to be there when you get back.
Well, that is true.
So if Chris West comes in and does nearly as well as he did two weeks ago when he took a day off, a jury, whatever the hell you took a day off, if he's that good again, and God forbid he's that good for 6 consecutive days.
What do you mean that good? First of all,
then you may as well just stay in Orlando.
The only reason he did a halfway decent job is I gave him every note you possibly could on where things were and what to do.
Yeah.
And he still messed them up from what I understand, But don't use that. Don't start going there with it. He was so good.
He was really
fear
good.
For my
God,
job
he was so good. He was.
What do you mean he's so
he
good?
Was
he was
funny.
Not so good.
Oh, he was funny. He was self-deprecating.
Well, that's him.
He banged some chick with a half a mouth of teeth in the parking lot at the swap shop. That's a real guy. That's an American. He like you did admit he's got a horrendous marijuana problem.
Well, I never admitted that.
Right, what do you do? The difference is he really can't afford his, and then his roommate stole his last $40, so he's basically blowing guys around the station to buy a bag of weed. This guy's the best.
Well, you know, I mean,
but listen,
if this is the fate, you know, of the show and
right.
the direct, you know,
Alicia I comes mean- first.
Well,
it is much
I mean,
more important that Alicia becomes officially Alicia Lengel.
This little thing we're doing up in Orlando is kind of important to her, yes.
Not really.
No.
Because I think you'd rather have a good job and get paid and be unmarried than be married and have no work. You're still, you're going to be with her anyway. You've been with her for 10 years. So now, because of this stupid piece of paper, which really means nothing, you're actually taking the risk that you're going to be married and jobless.
Well, she's still waiting for me to get the good job. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, by the way, so is my wife. 888-640-9385. We'll take a short break. We're back after this.
You're hearing Sid Rosenberg on 640 Sports.
There's been no communication or anyone at this point claiming responsibility. Skies, as is pointed out here, are perfectly clear this morning in New York, and so the likelihood of any plane having accidentally strayed from its intended flight path into the World Trade Center is almost impossible.
Wow.
Mayor Giuliani holding a news conference at the corner of Park Place and Church Street in Manhattan about what has happened, this absolutely horrific, unbelievable scene in the financial district of New York City this morning. No word at this point on what has happened so far as casualties are concerned. There was one early report, unconfirmed, that perhaps a half dozen fatalities had been reported. But
there's no traffic being let into the city. You can leave the outbound George and Washington Bridge and Lincoln Tunnel, but that is it. Other than that, you can't get in or out of
really?
The city.
So they have sealed off New York City, at least certainly Manhattan.
It's a prayer for our fallen brothers and sisters. There's a blood-red circle on the cold, dark ground, and the rain is falling down. The church door's thrown open. I can hear the organ song, but the congregation's gone. My city of ruins, my city of ruins.
That's the actual audio, chilling stuff of me and, well, that was Charles McCord and Don Imus that morning. And you know it's early on there because you heard McCord say in an early report of it, maybe a half a dozen dead. And we know, of course, that nearly 3,000 perished that day before it was all said and done in lower Manhattan. And I can't play enough of that stuff the next 2 days, especially with what's going on with this Iran deal. I spent so much time yesterday listening to Joyce, did a great job with that. Sean Hannity, basically all of Hannity's show yesterday was about the Iran deal. And I can't play enough of that stuff to remind you folks, that there are still people out there that celebrate that day, want more days like that in this country and in Israel, and that's Iran. And it may not be everybody there. I'm aware that the people, the Iranian people, do appreciate the West. A lot of them would like to live like we do here. A lot of them were in the streets of Tehran back in 2009 begging Barack Obama for help. I get all that. And it's unfortunate that some of those people live in that depressed, oppressed society. But the regime, the government, the people that run that place, from the Ayatollah to the rest of those folks, they want us all dead, all of us dead. And the unimaginable fact that this president, who is the least patriotic, listen, you can argue all day about the worst, the best president of all time, the worst president. In my lifetime, Jimmy Carter and Barack Obama are neck and neck for the worst president. And some of you say, George Bush, look, Bush's second term was a disaster. I admit that. His second term was a disaster. And so is Obama's, by the way. But in my lifetime, the two worst presidents, as bad as Bush was, Obama and Carter. And this creep that's in the White House right now is the least patriotic and least American of anybody, of any of these guys. At least Carter loved this country, and he didn't love Israel, but just like Obama. But I think he tried. This guy is just, he's the worst possible human being. And he's out there making deals with the enemy, so just take a listen throughout today and tomorrow when we commemorate what happened to our country that day, because the people that you're doing the deal with, some of you Jews out there, you disgusting, rotten people like W. Wasserman Schultz that are okay with this deal because you're placing partisan politics and party agenda in front of the security and safety of your people of America and in Israel. Take a good listen to some of this audio. That will play. As Warner Wolf describes, the buildings crumbling and young folks, 21, 20 years old, with their lives ahead of them, jumping out of the 100th floor because they'd rather die that way than burn to death from the jet fuel. And these are the types of folks we're doing deals with today, guys. Just remember that. And if you think they've changed, or if you think this deal is going to change them and bring them around, that all of a sudden these evildoers, the lowest form of life God has ever created, who want us all dead, all of a sudden, because of a piece of paper in front of them, they're going to come around, then you're somewhere between naive and stupid and closer to the latter. Now we'll give them $150 billion so they can absolutely make sure their ballistics programs, their nuclear programs, all the money they siphon to Hezbollah, to Hamas, Al-Qaeda, ISIL, who knows. Now they got plenty of that too. Just remember that. Remember that when I play all of these bits the next 2 days. These are not bits, excuse me, all of this audio. I was there, okay? I didn't live in Boca. Sorry, Steve White and Gino Toretta, but it's not the same. I wasn't watching all of it on Channel 7. I lived it. I couldn't get home from Queens. There were no trains. I had to walk across the bridge, walk to the Upper East Side with my wife, who I swear to God, I've never been more worried than that day, because Danielle worked right across the street from the Empire State Building, and I thought for sure that was next. I figured they're going to hit the Trade Center. They're going to hit the Empire State Building. They're going to hit the FBI building. They're going to hit the Pentagon. They're going to hit the White House. I called Danielle. I said, Dan, get the F out of there. Get out. And she got out. And she walked outside of her building. And she watched. And actually described it for me on the phone. I'll never forget this. I was in the WFAN studios and cried as the buildings crumbled to the ground. The first tower. David, good morning. How are you?
Yes, good morning. How are you? Good. I also love my niece in 9/11. She just lived in the Bronx. She was going to an interview that day in the building. She perished.
Yeah.
But it's a couple of comments you made about President Obama being the worst president we ever had.
Yeah.
I think Ronald Reagan took that title. If you recall, Ronald Reagan's administration delayed the release of the hostages so they can get credit for it. The whole Iran-Contra thing. So I have to disagree with you wholeheartedly that President Obama is the worst president we ever had. I think
President Obama wishes, but please, David, you sound like a halfway decent guy. Don't ever put Barack Obama and Ronald Reagan in the same sentence. That will be, I'll tell you this right now, David, your comment just now will be the dumbest comment of the week. I know that Reagan wasn't perfect. I do understand the Iran-Contra thing was a disaster for him. The whole Star Wars program was not good. I understand a lot of the middle class was upset with Ronald Reagan, but Ronald Reagan was everything that Barack Obama is not. Ronald Reagan was the most patriotic president in my lifetime. In my lifetime, no one's come close to Ronald Reagan restoring the patriotism day one. Well, here we were in 1979, you know, with Jimmy Carter boycotting the Olympics, gas lines that were miles and miles and miles long, hostages rotting away in Iran, and Ronald took over and all of that changed overnight. Now, again, a lot of his policies were up, and he spent an awful lot of money on the military. I understand that a lot, and that made a lot of liberals very, very unhappy. But you couldn't sound dumber than that. Don't ever put Barack Obama and Ronald Reagan in the same sentence, you dumb bastard. We'll take a short break. Stu Bonner's next.